Hello and welcome to ML with AP. We are continuing with our journey on ensemble learning and we have reached towards the end. This is the last topic, XGBoost or Extreme Gradient Boost. XGBoost will deal in two videos. The first video will try to walk through the intuition behind XGBoost. We'll try to see why XGBoost is needed, what improvement it has done over gradient boosting. We'll also try to walk through an example so that we'll solidify your understanding about XGBoost. In the second video, what we'll see is the maths behind XGBoost. We'll also try to code using scikit-learn. So without further ado, let's jump right in. First thing first, there are certain prerequisites before you jump into this video. And the prerequisite is decision tree and gradient boosting. If you do not know how decision tree works, how splitting works, what is entropy, what is Gini index, I request you to pause this video and go back to my playlist about decision tree and watch it over there and then come back. Similarly, my last video on ensemble learning was around gradient boosting. If you have not seen that, please go ahead and watch that. XGBoost is nothing but extreme gradient boosting, which is built on top of gradient boost. So think it like this. Everything which is true for gradient boost will be true for extreme gradient boosting also. And we are going to put some improvements on top of it. Okay, so it's extremely important that you understand gradient boosting as well. Okay, with that being said, let's jump right in. The first question which comes to my mind, what is this XGBoost when we already have gradient boostings? Now, there were a couple of problems with gradient boosting and there were two or three major issues. Let's see. Gradient boost, as you know, is an additive model. Additive means it's a sequential model, iterative model, one after the another, slow to train. And since it is slow to train, it is also computationally intensive. It takes longer time to train it, okay? Because it has to be trained sequentially. If there are T iterations in a gradient boost, then you cannot train everything in parallel. You have to go from 1 to 2 to 3 to 4 to TF model, right? Overfitting is another issue. In gradient boost, we do not use stumps. We use mostly fully grown trees. And the large number of iterations and models will make it, if you are using almost fully grown trees, then there is no natural way to overcome overfitting, right? And you have to leverage your regularization techniques, right? So overfitting was another issue which was not dealt within the model for gradient boosting. The third thing, we are living in the age of big data. We have humongous amount of data. Gradient boost, since it is sequential and it runs one by one, the large data sets, if you deploy gradient boosting on large data set, it becomes challenging and computationally intensive, right? Extreme gradient boost or XGBoost tries to solve all these issues, okay? And we'll see that how it solves. But before that, let's see that what is so big deal about XGBoost. XGBoost is one of the most popular algorithms when it comes to classical machine learning. Only perhaps deep learning is going to beat XGBoost in terms of its predictive power or accuracy, right? And this is evident with this particular graph, right? If you see, and the measure of the predictive power is area under ROC curve, right? If you see over here, and this can maximum go to one. One means like highest predictive power. You are predicting everything correctly. And the second column which you see is over the training time. You see the predictive power of the AU ROC is 96.62% for XGBoost. On some test data which was done using 5-fold cross validation, 1 million randomly generated using make classification data set. So a scikit-learn has this make classification. You can make your own data and then you can train your model, right, with a toy data set. The training time. So it is not only huge in predictive power, but the training time is also very less, right? If it is in seconds, it's 24 seconds. With respect to that, if you see gradient boosting, the next one, it is the predictive power is okay, but you see the training time over here, It is probably 100 times more or something. Random forest, the predictive power goes low. Logistic regression, it goes further, right? It is faster. Logistic regression, no doubt, is faster, but the predictive power is low. So XG boost does this balancing act of higher predictive power as well as faster training, right? That makes sense. Okay, so that's why there is a famous quote in the world of all the competitions which are going on in Kaggle and all, that when in doubt, use XGBoost. So XGBoost perhaps is the most popular algorithm in classical machine learning. And if you leave the deep learning part, when in doubt, if you want the highest accuracy, I'll just go with the XGBoost. XGBoost again is the winner of most of the competition in Kaggles, right? And this is the original paper by Tianqi Chen. And these two gentlemen have been, this algorithm have been founded or discovered or invented by them rather, right? Have been proposed by them. So this is their original paper. And in this paper, they are saying that 29 challenges winning solutions published at Kaggle's blog during 2015, 17 solutions used XGBoost. So this is quite dated. This is probably before deep learning become very, very mainstream, right? Before that, out of 29 challenges which were won on Kaggle, right? The Netflix challenge and other challenges, 17 of those winning challenges or winning teams used XGBoost, right? So that's how that much popular it was. Again, this is again from Kaggle. And they had done a survey of all the, so scikit-learn or on the frameworks or the packages, they did the survey. Scikit-learn came top because it has inbuilt APIs for everything which is to deal with classical machine learning, right? TensorFlow, obviously TensorFlow and Keras should be the number two because this is the framework for your deep learning, right? The third comes XGBoost, right, over here. Now, why XGBoost is separate from scikit-learn? Because XGBoost only provides a wrapper to scikit-learn, right? It is a complete package on its own, okay? But to make it compatible with scikit-learn, there is a wrapper also which is provided on top so that you can do your all the scikit-learn related operations, that model.fit and predict, everything you can do with XGBoost. But XGBoost is released as a separate package altogether, right? And but we have a wrapper on top of it so that you can call it from within scikit-learn also, right? That's why it is separately mentioned over here. Okay, with that being said, let's see that what are the algorithmic improvements which were done in XGBoost over gradient boosting, which made it so popular among all the competitions and in the industry. The first and the foremost is the inbuilt regularization. So friends, if you know about L1, L2 regularization, I have also put a video on these two topics. Most of the models, the regularization is not inbuilt within the algorithm. Okay, in case of gradient boosting, in case of random forest, you have to put regularization when the time of training, right? So whether you do a L2 or a lasso or a ridge regression penalty, you have to do that. But in case of XGBoost, regularization is built within the model itself, within the algorithm itself, right? So there are parameters, hyperparameters, which are related to regularization, which is inbuilt within XGBoost itself. So this model or this algorithm comes packed with regularization, right? And hence, it will never overfit, right? If you tune your hyperparameters accordingly, right, it will never overfit, right, and it will have always have low variance. Includes earliest stopping. What is earliest stopping? Earliest stopping is that when you are making your decision trees, right? So this is XGBoost is nothing but an ensemble tree algorithm, right? So the base of that will be a decision tree. When you are building the decision tree, don't build it fully grown decision tree. There is inbuilt mechanism which will prevent you from growing the tree further. That means that is the term which is called earliest stopping. So it will ask you, the algorithm will tell you that, hey, beyond this, you cannot grow your decision tree, right? You have to stop it over here. And it is not just based on the number of leaves. It is more complicated than that. We'll just see it in a minute, right? But at this moment of time, just see that unlike most of our machine learning algorithms, regularization is built in XGBoost. The second thing which it has done is a sparse-aware algorithm and null value treatment. Now, what is a sparse-aware algorithm? A sparse-aware, if you know the sparse matrix, right? If you have heard this term, that means it has, if the matrix or my tabular data has many, or the data frame has many null values or NaN or zeros, those are called sparse tabular data, sparse data, right? So the algorithmic improvement done in XGBoost is that it has inbuilt mechanism to treat sparse data. So if my data set has a lot of NaN or zeros, right? It has a mechanism to train those, to take that into account and still train it faster. And it also does the null value treatment. Now let's see if that, what is the meaning of null value treatment? Okay. So let's see, I'm taking a very small data set over here, this particular data set, right? So this is my observation number, 1, 2, 3, 4. I have 4 observations only. I have 2 features, age and gender, okay? And my output, this is Y, this is X2, this is X1, let's say, okay? So I have 2 features and 1 output variable label, okay? So it is age and gender. And the prediction is, on my Y label is, plays video games, yes or no. So yes, plays video game, no, doesn't play video game. Let's say, in case of real world, you know very well that there will be a lot of data which will be missing, right? There will always be missing. And then there are imputation techniques and all. Now it's a lot of hard work for the data scientist to do those imputation. And those imputation techniques, whether they are foolproof or not, is something also debatable. Sometimes what people will do is that, okay, whatever is the next observation, you fill it over here, right? Because our machine learning model doesn't work well with null or NaN values, right? It always expects a value, a numerical value, so that we can fit our model, right? Now, the other technique would be that, okay, you take a mean or an average or a median or a mode or whatever, and then impute these values. All the missing values, you say that, okay, whatever is the median, whatever is my 50th percent, or whatever is my mode, the most frequently occurring, let me fit it with that, okay? In case of numerical, we can take mean. So if the mean of these 3 figures or these 3 numbers, whatever is coming, let's say 25, I'll put this as 25. This is the imputation technique generally followed, right? The null value treatment for XGBoost is slightly different. What it's saying is don't impute the values. Leave it to the model, leave it to the algorithm. How it does in a simple way. Let's see. So over here, if you see, if suppose I have dividing it based on age, my first node, the root node, I'm dividing it based on age less than 16, right? Age less than 16 is 1 and 2, right? 1, 2 and 4. 4 is also age is 7. So 1, 2, 4 will come over here. Now, age less than 16, there is a missing value over here. I do not know where this missing value age, this particular observation, it should go on left side or right side. I do not know. What I will try to do is, I will try to make a default path for all the missing feet, all the missing values for the feature age. Let me repeat that. What algorithm will do is, algorithm will decide that, let me decide a default path, whether it's left or right. Whether it's left or right, let me decide a default path for this particular feature, right? And all the missing values which it has. So for this age, let's say the default missing value direction is left. So no matter where, we do not know what is the age of this particular observation, right? But since the default is decided by the algorithm as left, we'll put it on the left side. That's why 1 is also coming. 2, 4, obviously we know it is 15 and 7, which is less than 16, right? As our condition. But 1 is also coming because my missing value default direction for age feature is left. I'll put it over here. Similarly, in case of gender, this is missing, right? Over here. Now, missing For gender, let's say the algorithm decides that it's a right direction, and it will put 2 over here, 1/4 goes over here, right? Because 1/4 are male, right? The female goes over here. Is male true? Goes this. If female, if is male false? Goes in this direction, right? The default direction for this missing value or for this gender feature is right. That's why 2 comes over here, 1/4 goes over here. Makes sense? Now, how this is useful? These default directions of the missing values. So similarly, I was saying that the age missing goes left. This is the default directions, right? Gender missing goes right. And similarly, model will decide that whether it goes left or right. Okay. What model is doing is that when it is training the model, when it is training the model, it is also learning. And simultaneously, it is also learning that what is the best default directions for my missing values. What is the best? And by virtue of that, what it is doing is it is able to make a better guess or prediction about those missing values, right? Correct? So what it is learning, it is not only learning how the split should happen. At the same time, my model or algorithm is also learning that what should be the most probable values for those missing values, right? And how it is doing? By assigning a default direction, training the model, seeing the parameters associated with that, and then discovering that, right? Correct? Okay, let's go back. So that is the meaning of sparse aware algorithms and null value treatment. That is an algorithmic improvement in XGBoost. The third thing is weighted approximate quantile sketch. Now these are lot of big words, weighted approximate quantile sketch, right? What is it? Quantile sketch is already a proven algorithm. I'll try to give you a flavor of that, what it is, okay? Let's go back over here. Weighted approximate quantile feature, quantile sketch. Okay, a sketch. Now, friends, do you know what is a greedy algorithm? Let's try to understand what is a greedy algorithm. The greedy algorithm is what we do in case of decision trees. Okay, any decision tree we are building, we are using the greedy algorithm. Why it is called greedy? Because when we are building, when we have, let's say we have features S1, S2, S3. Like we have 3 features over here. And Y is our target variable, right? Y is our target variable. Suppose when we are doing this particular thing, right? What we are doing is, when we are doing the split of the tree, when we are doing the split of the tree, we are only looking at that particular, let me draw it as an example. Suppose we are doing a split of the tree, okay? We are calculating the information gain only at this level, right? Where we are doing the split, correct? We are not bothered that going down the road, right? Whether this split will still result in the maximum information gain or not, we are not bothered. At this point in time, when we are splitting, we are only bothered that, okay, when I'm splitting, am I gaining the maximum gain or not? I do not care about the future splits, okay? So that's why it is greedily building the tree. Greedily in the sense, it is not bothered about what will happen in future. In future, it may happen. The way the split works is that this particular split may not be, if you take future also into account, this particular split may not result in the maximum information gain. Still, you are splitting at this because all you are concerned about is only the immediate splits, right? Immediate child nodes. You are not considered of what is happening in future. That is called greedy algorithm. Okay, that is greedy algorithm. Now let's see that what is this weighted approximate quantile sketch. Now, as I was saying, quantile sketch is already an algorithm. What it does, what is quantile? Quantile is like percentile, right? When you are splitting a data set into several, let's say, you know about the quartile, right? What is quartile? Quartile is 25%, right? So if you have a data set and the first 25% data here, second 25%, this is the median, this will be the median, this will be the 75th percentile, and this is the top, right? So this is 25% of the data. So first quartile data, second quartile, third quartile, and fourth quartile, right? This is quartile. Similarly, quantile is what? When we are dividing it into maybe 100 or in some numbers, right? When we are dividing the data set into that many splits, that is quantile. What is this approximate? Now, let me show you over here. Okay, so quantile is nothing but when we partition our data set. Let's say we have the data set like this particular, right? So we split into three parts, okay? By drawing two boundaries, we are splitting the data into three parts, 1, 2, and 3, right? Now, if you recall how the decision tree split works, right? In case of categorical features, how it works? It will take every feature into account at every layer of a split, and it will try to see that what is the Gini index, what is the entropy, or what is the information gain I am getting, whether you are employing Gini index or entropy, what is the information gain after the split I am getting, right? And then it decides on the categorical features. In case of numerical, what it does? Numerical, what it will do? For numerical, if you know, then if let's say if in I have only one feature x1, I have to build a decision tree, and these are numerical features, let's say, what it will do? My decision tree algorithm works that first I will find a mean of these two values, right? And I'll do a split over here. Okay, so this is my first split, right? This is my first split. Again, I will compare it with doing the split between mean of these two. Second split, right? Again, I will do the split over here. Third split, right? Fourth split, right? I will keep on doing this split and measuring, right? What will happen? If my data set is 100,000, I can do the splits, right? And I can measure and I can see that what is the best split, right? But is this the most effective algorithm? Think about when you have a million records, right? Or a million observations, and you have a numerical feature. How you will do the split? Are you going to build the split million times or million minus one times and then calculate? No, you don't do that. What you do is that we do not want the best split. Perhaps an approximate split is also okay with me. Approximate. That's why the term is coming approximate, right? Approximate quantile. What this algorithm is doing, and the default value for that is 33, right? Is that it splits the data into multiple partitions, right? Like this is one partition, this is second partition. This is similar to what binning is in the histogram, right? We do binning. So it will, in a predefined, and the default is 33, it will split my whole data into 33 partitions, okay? Then it will take the mean of this partition, and this is my first split, right? This will be my first split. The mean of this is my second split. The mean of this is my third split. Similarly, it will have 1, 2, 3, and maybe 33 splits, right? If it has 33 splits, right, then it will get 33 mean values. Right? 33. So instead of what it has done, out of all the million records, 1 million records, for example, right? Rather than parsing and seeing what is the best fit for my 1 million record, it is doing an approximation with only these 33 partitions. I'm not partitioning 1 million because that doesn't help me to that extent. And it is very computationally intensive. What I will rather do, I will split it into 33 parts itself, right? And then I will take the mean of this, and these will be my best split candidates, right? This will be. So one of these 33 candidates, 33 is a default number, you can set it any number, but one of these 33 splits candidates will be my most best fit candidate, right? Or the best split candidate. That is the meaning of approximate quantile sketch or partitioning. That's what it is. Okay? Make sense? Let's go over here back. So we have learned about the inbuilt regularization, a sparse aware algorithm, and null value treatment. We have also got the intuition of what is weighted approximate quantile sketch. Now there are, apart from that, since this is built for big data problems, XGBoost, right, where we have large amount of data, we also have to do with some system optimization, which is inbuilt over here. One is the parallel computing. XGBoost does support GPU also, but in case of CPU also, it has the capability to do parallel computing leveraging multiple cores. If you have multiple cores on your CPU, it can leverage all the cores. Out of core computing. What is out of core computing? Out of core computing, that again is the fundamental, that what it will do is it will split my data out of core. That means it will split my data into multiple partitions. It will keep it on the disk, and as and when needed, it will bring into the memory, process it, push it back into the disk, right? So a larger amount of data can be processed on a smaller CPU or number of cores, right? That is the technique behind out of core computing. Now the third is distributed computing. What is distributed computing? If you know about the big data and the Hadoop system, that is distributed. That means this processing is not happening only on one big computer. It is spread across multiple computers, right? So you can do computations parallelly on multiple computers simultaneously and then aggregate the result for your final prediction. That is distributed computing. So I'm not going to the detail of how the system optimizations are working. We'll probably more deal with how the algorithmic improvements have been done on the software side. Okay. In short, what is it? It is XGBoost is nothing but a faster version of gradient boosting. So everything which is true for gradient boosting still applies for your XGBoost. And along with that, you have certain improvements also on top of it. Okay. So now next, what we are talking about, the first thing, that you have regularization inbuilt, right? So any objective function or cost function, right? For any machine learning algorithm, it is true that we have a loss function. Over here, my cost function is my default loss function plus my regularization penalty also, right? So my objective function for my, the default objective function for my XGBoost is baked in with regularization, right? That was the first. What these individual term refers, the loss function in case of a linear, let's say mean square error, right? If you are, my loss is mean square error, it will be yi hat minus yi the whole square, right? And summation of all the observations, right? This is my loss, mean square loss, MSE or RSS, whatever we call that. What it represents? It represents that my training loss, right? How well my model fit on my training data. This is what it is encountering, right? It is just trying to chase or minimize the difference or the residual between the observed and my predicted, right? And it should come down. So it is the whole objective or the goal of this particular term or this particular loss, if you are minimizing our objective function, is to bring this quantity down. Bringing this quantity down means bringing closer to zero. That means bringing closer and closer my loss or residual. That means my yi should be almost equal to yi. My yi hat should be almost be equal to yi. So this is the goal of this particular function. The omega theta, right, which is being said, is the regularization penalty, right? And what kind of regularization we have in case of XGBoost is a L2 norm. So in friends, if you have not watched my regularization videos, please go ahead and watch. I have dealt of about lasso and ridge regression. This is the L2 penalty. This is my penalty term, right? My hyperparameter lambda. And this is the L2 norm, right? My weight, the whole square, right? This is one beta 1 whole square plus beta 2 whole square. This is nothing but that. So this regularization or L2 regularization or ridge regression is also ridge penalty is already baked into the objective function, right? Now before we go into the our example and the dry run, we need to have certain concepts clear, right? About decision tree and about gradient boosting. I have told you before the start of the video also that these two are prerequisite. Now, just as a quick recap, let's see what decision tree. So decision tree, you recall how trees were formed. What we used to do, we used to calculate the either the Gini index or the entropy, Gini impurity or the entropy. And then we used to calculate the information gain. Okay. And based on the information gain, we'll decide that which split among all the split candidates, which split is the best. right? So no split, how it was being done? It was being done through gene impurity or entropy and information gain. In case of classification for the final prediction, what we'll do? We used to take the majority vote. If a prediction has come to a particular leaf node and there are, in case of classification settings, there are 3y and 2n's, what we'll take? We'll majority vote, that 3y is the majority vote, we'll take 3. Okay, so we'll take y as the prediction of that particular, from that particular leaf, right? In case of regression, what we used to do? We used to take the mean or the average of all the elements present in that particular leaf, right? So let's say 1, 3, 5 is present, 3 elements. 3 will be the average, so we'll predict 3. This is what, so if you remember these things, then you are good. In case of gradient boosting, what we used to do? Recall how sequentially trees were built? How trees were built? They were built sequentially, one after the other, because it's an additive model, okay? And what we used to do, if you recall, we used to work on something called pseudo-residual. Why it was called pseudo-residual? Because we used to fit our next generation or the next iteration of model, of our tree model, not on the output, but on the residual. We used to fit on the residual, right? Correct? If you recall that, that's why it was called pseudo-residual, used for fitting the next iteration of tree. That, and then after that, what we used to do, there was something called learning rate, alpha. We used to multiply that with the prediction of the DT using the residual as y, and we used to predict, and then that used to become the, this learning rate was nothing but the step size, right, of the gradient descent. So that used to become our small steps towards the global optimum values, right? If you recall those concepts from the gradient boosting, that how the trees were split, okay, how the pseudo residual used to be calculated, what was alpha at that time, okay, you are good, right? Then we can go ahead with the our example, okay? Let's go ahead with the, let's see the first example, okay? For that, I will go over here. This is my example, okay? So I have a very small example, again, very simple to demonstrate the concepts, right? What I have over here is, I have one feature and one output. So my feature is walking in kilometers, okay? And my output is calories or kilocalories, how much I have burned, right? So suppose I have, the, my first observation is I walk 4 kilometers, I burned 10 kilocalories. Similarly, 8 and 17, both are numerical feature, right? Very easy, right? And this will, through this will demonstrate that how XG boost algorithm works, right? Through a dry learner. Okay, so we understood this toy data set, right? Walking and kilocalories, right? Now there are a few important concepts before we need to know that which is different from the decision tree. So one thing which is there is the similarity score. There is a concept of similarity score. Now, similarity score, you can relate it to your entropy or your Gini index. Okay. If you are knowing about entropy and Gini index, it is something which very, very similar. Okay. And the way it is calculated is using this formula. So similarity index is calculated the sum of the residuals square. So residual square, and then the square of that, right? You sum the, you square of that, okay? So it is actually the, like this, okay? So you sum all the residuals and then you take a square of it, right? It is like this, okay? And divided by n. What is n over here? N is my number of leaf nodes, right? Number of leaf nodes. Lambda is my hyperparameter. Okay, so that is the first thing, that similarity score is something which we have to know. We'll know in the second video that how similarity score, or we'll see the maths behind it. But for the time being, just compare it with your Gini impurity or your entropy, right? And treat it similarly. Information gain is what? In case of entropy also, we used to call similarity score of the right node, similarity score plus of the left node, minus similarity score of the root, right? So this is our information gain. Our split condition is based on this information gain, right? Okay. And friends, remember, the splitting also is taking the approximate quantile sketch, right? If you recall, then we are partitioning not into the million partitions, but we are only taking the splits of the approximate, right? We are dividing into 33 or whatever number of quantiles or partitions, and we are taking the mean of that, and those are the best candidate splits, right? So all those things are already there behind. But information gain is nothing but my similarity on the right, similarity on the left, minus similarity of the root. That how much information I am gaining, correct? There is also something in case of our gradient boosting or gradient boosting especially, right? What used to be the output value? The output value is the leaf value, right? When you are doing the prediction, what used to be the leaf, right? As I was saying, in case of decision tree, in case of classification, it is majority vote. But in case of regression, what is mean? What is mean? Mean is nothing but like this, right? My residual sum by n, right? This is what you used to do in case of gradient boosting also. But over here, we are adding an extra parameter, hyperparameter, which is lambda. Okay, we'll come to the hyperparameter just in a bit, right? But this is how the output value also changes in case of XG boost. We'll also try to get the intuition that why we are adding lambda over here also and over here also, right? Both the places we are adding lambda, right? Otherwise, it makes sense. This particular thing makes sense, right? Intuitively, it makes sense. Okay. Now, there are three hyperparameters in case of this. In case of gradient boosting, what was there? Alpha. Over here, alpha is assigned to something else, so we call the learning rate or the gradient descent step size as eta. It's another Greek letter, eta, which is nothing but learning rate. In case of gradient boosting, we used to call it alpha. Here we are calling it eta. Gamma and lambda are two regularization parameter, hyperparameters, right, which are new in case of this. Lambda is nothing but your L2 penalty also, the same as L2 penalty. What is gamma? Gamma is a threshold for tree pruning. Remember, when I said how the regularization is inbuilt over here and with earliest stopping and all, how earliest stopping works? Earliest stopping works based on this parameter, hyperparameter gamma, right? So for a particular information gain, they have to cross the threshold. If they are not able to cross the threshold, will stop growing the tree right at this point. So gamma is nothing but a threshold. It is like a threshold or a measure that should you grow further tree or not, or should you stop at this moment in time itself. Okay, that is gamma. Okay, now let's see. So this was our toy example, and this is our similarity score, information gain, output value, eta, gamma, and lambda. Hopefully we understood these concepts, right? Now let's see. So in case of a split, for example's sake, let's say our best split or one of the split is coming as kilometer less than equal to 6. Now my first thing is saying that kilometer less than 6, less than equal to 6, that this and this data point will go towards my left side. What should be the, again, like if you recall the gradient boosting in case of regression setting, the output for this particular thing at the root itself was nothing but the mean. Why it was coming as mean at that time? Because we are taking the mean square loss. Recall that. Okay. So my output, if I do not grow any tree underneath and just leave it at the root, right, then the output will be 17.2. If this is 17.2, right, what will be my residuals value for all the five observations? 17.2, 10 minus 17.2, 7.2. The residuals at this level are calculated like this. What is the residual? 10 minus 17.2, 17 minus 17.2, minus 0.02. Similarly, since I am doing a split at kilometer less than equal to 6, what will happen over here? What will happen over here? These two, this and this feature will go on the left, and what will be the residual associated with that? 7.2 and 4.2, correct? The rest three will come over here, minus 0.2, 3.8, 7.8. What are the rest three? This point, and this point, right? It will come on the right, correct? Then what we do is we calculated the similarity score or SS. How we calculate the similarity score? The formula was sum of residual, the whole square, n plus lambda. and we have to assume certain value of lambda, okay? So let's say we assume the lambda is equal to 1, right? Then what will happen? Over here, the similarity score is calculated. How the similarity score is calculated? The residuals. So this plus this, the whole square, right? This plus this, the whole square, divided by n. What will be the n over here? 2 plus 1 lambda 3, right? That become my similarity score for here. What will be the output? The output, friends, if you recall over here, the output value was the sum of the residual by n plus lambda, correct? So output will be my sum of this by n by 2. In case of normal regression or boost, gradient boosting, we would have just divided by 2. But here we are divided by 2 plus lambda, which is 3. And then output is coming as minus 2.85, right? Correct. Similarly, we'll calculate the output for this also. What will be the gain? Whether this split is good or not, we have to calculate. And similarly, many splits will happen, the candidate splits. The gain is, similarly like how the information gain works, is 58.48. SS right node, 32. SS left node, SS right node, minus SS root. Why SS root is 0? If you sum everything, in case of a regression setting, it will become 0, right? Because it is deviating from the mean. So minus 7.2, minus 0.2, minus 4.2, 3.8, 7.8. Everything, the sum of them is 0. So the numerator becomes 0, right? So it will be 0. So over here, this is my gain. Now, as I was saying, this gamma is a threshold, right? It lets you that whether you should prune, whether you should grow the tree further or not. So my gain minus gamma, if positive, then continue building the tree. If my gain minus gamma is negative, then stop over here, right? Correct? My gain minus gamma, that means my gain has to cross the threshold of gamma for me to continue building the tree. If my gain is not crossing the level of gamma, that means I have to stop it. I can't grow further tree. Okay. What is the gain over here? The gain is something over here, 58.48. Let's say gamma I set it as 30. Okay. Gamma I set it at 30. Now, gain minus gamma is 28.48. It is positive, right? So I should continue building this tree. This is allowed, right? Because my regularization threshold gamma is set as 30, right? Again, that gamma is identified through a hyperparameter tuning, right? Or cross-validation. You have to employ cross-validation techniques to find the hyperparameter search to find the right value of gamma. Okay, so this is the intuition behind gamma. The lambda we all know is the L2 penalty, right? And which is also baked into over here in all these formulas, right? And we'll see clearly that how these formulas work, right? Now the question is when to stop. One thing we already know is the gain minus gamma becomes a negative, then you stop, right? Or the number of trees have reached. Suppose in case of gradient boosting also, we normally take 8 to 32 like trees, right? Or the leaves. If the leaf has reached 8 to 32 numbers at the bottom, then you stop growing after that. Otherwise you will start doing the overfitting, right? That is empirical. So this is how now what is the impact of lambda, right? In case of gradient boosting, what we used to do, if you recall, we used to do residual by n, right? We used to do residual by n in case of regression setting in gradient boosting. Over here, we are adding an extra term, which is lambda over here, right? What is the impact of lambda on output? If lambda is greater than 1, lambda is any positive number, and lambda has to be greater than 0, right? Any positive number. What it will do? It will bring the output down. It will tone it down. When the output is toned down, when my output is toned down, right, what will happen? Then it will have an impact on my gain. And similarly, on the gain will also depend on, because I have lambda over here also on the SS. So my overall, because of lambda, my SS is also coming down. Let's try to see the impact of lambda on SS first, right? SS is tied to what? Information gain, correct? If lambda is a positive quantity, and it is greater than 0 always, what is the impact of? The greater the lambda, smaller the SS. smaller the S is, even a smaller gamma will be able to cross the threshold, will not be able to cross the threshold, right? My gain will become smaller. So when my gain will become smaller, that means it is acting as a pruning step, right? It is not letting my tree to grow further. If I increase lambda, my tree will be shorter and shorter, right? You got that? Why it will be shorter and shorter? Because my SS will keep coming down. SS keep coming down, right? That means this threshold will become, this particular quantity will become negative very easily, right? Because my gain will come down. Gain will come down. Then for any value of gamma, it will actually, for a smaller value of gamma also, for the fixed value of gamma, my gain minus gamma will soon become negative, right? Because my gain is smaller. If the gain is smaller, what does it mean? That means I'm pruning the trees. The trees is not growing further, no overfitting, right? So that is the impact on that. On impact of output, what was the output here? This output is the output of the decision tree, right? And I'm multiplying this with the alpha to get to the next step. So this is like a step. So with this parameter, I'm putting it over here. That means I'm taking smaller and smaller steps, right? In that gradient descent, I'm taking a smaller and smaller step. If you recall, I'm taking a smaller and smaller step to reach to the minimum, right? So it is toning it down. It is toning down my output further, because this output is going to get multiplied by alpha learning rate. Or in case of here, it is eta, right? In case of gradient boosting, it is eta. So this will, but we'll see that again with the Excel example. Let's see. So if you come over here, this walk in kilometer calories, again the same thing, same data set. What is this thing, 17.2? Nothing but the mean of this, right? If you see, this is the average, the mean of this, okay? Residual at root, this is what we are calculating, the residual at root. How this will calculate? This will calculate with this minus 17.2. So B2 minus C2, right? This is calculated. So my residual at root will be calculated. Kilometer greater than 6, kilometer less than 6. What will be the value? 7.2. How this 7.2 is coming? This observation and this observation will go on the kilometers less than equal to 6 node, right? These two observations. These three will remain over here on the greater than 6, correct? What will be the output? Let's see the output, how it is calculated. Output is nothing but the sum of these, sum of the residuals divided by count, how many n divided by n, plus what is B20, lambda. Lambda, if I have set it as 2, this is the formula, it's come 2.28. Over here, it is come minus 2.85, correct? So the first candidate split is done, correct? What will be the similarity score? The formula is the sum of residual squares, n plus lambda. Similarity score for this will be 0. Why it will be 0? If you sum everything them, you are doing the summing, you are doing the squaring by n plus lambda, the sum itself becomes 0. Okay, this becomes 0. Over here, if you run this formula for similarity score, it is 25.992. Over here, on the other node, on the other side, 32.49. What is the gain? Left similarity plus right similarity minus root similarity, 58.482, correct? What was the output? Output was created. This thing is created using this formula. Output is residual by n plus lambda. What is lambda? Lambda is 2, I am calculating over here, correct? Till now, we understood that how this data is coming, right? How this data is coming. Now, similarly, we'll build multiple trees, right? Candidate trees, and we'll see the best tree, okay? Now, after that, similarly, how gradient boosting is done. What we'll do in case of gradient boosting, we used to call it alpha, the step size of the learning rate. Here we are calling eta. Eta is 0.3. What we'll do is eta into prediction. How we are getting the prediction? What will the prediction? The prediction is nothing but for this particular, this is my output, right? What will be my prediction? The output of this, right? The output of this. In case of gradient boosting, regression, we only used to get mean. Now, it is not mean, but divided by n plus lambda also. So this is how our eta into prediction is calculated. For my tth model, T1 model, this is my T0. For my T1 model, what I will do? My T0, what was my T0? My base 10.17.2. This was my node prediction, right? Root node prediction. Over here, I will add this term to this term. This will become 16.345. Similarly, I will add on this. Now, friends, if you notice, my initial kilometer calories burned was 10, 17, 13, 21, 25. My root node prediction, just root node, was 17.2, which was mean, right? Now, after one step I took in this additive model, right, it is 16.345. From 17.2, it has lowered down. Lowered down means it is trying to reach closer to 10. Over here, 17.2 was there. The actual value is 17. This has gone 70 because it is oscillating. It is very close to our 17 value. It is oscillating. If it is 17.2 over here, right, and the value was 13, original value was 13. Now my value from 17.2 has reduced to 16.3. It is also going in the correct direction, minimizing. Similarly, for 21, I'm increasing from 17.2, I have increased to 17.884. It is increasing, so it is approaching 21. Similarly, for 25, it is approaching that, right? So if you know and see this, and you would appreciate that every step size, it is approaching towards its actual value, what was there. Similarly, for prediction also, and then we do not have to build only T1. Similarly, we have to build T2, T3, T4, T5, T6. Similarly, right? With the same concept, we'll build T1 to how many iterations we have to build, right? Like 10, 15, 20, 30. How many trees, additive models we have to build, we'll build. And ultimately, that final prediction of T1, right, we have to run, and that will give you, that will become very, 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 very closer to this. Right, very, very closer to this. Okay, so this is the concept, this is the running example for our XGBoost, and this is how I'm giving you a very simplified example just for regression and only with one feature, right? But you can extrapolate this with all the concepts which we have already baked in, and you can appreciate that how the tree is built in case of XGBoost. Okay, with that being said, I think I will close this video over here. In the next video, what we'll do is we'll try to go behind the maths behind XGBoost, and we'll also try to see that how we can code XGBoost using scikit-learn. With that being said, thank you. Bye.